Those who are new today, those who have been coming, no matter how many times you have been able to come to attend, I really appreciate very much. Very interesting. You are already looking at a very important piece of information there with a lot of feedback. Now we are putting numbers, finally. We are listening, and it's exciting. I've been looking at that. I was gone last week. I was in Spain leading a pilgrimage to Santiago de Compostela, northern Spain. It went very well, thanks God, with a group of Americans and a group of Spaniards all together, youth. Now I got to see that today, and now these past couple of days, and I'm very excited. Let's start with a prayer and a couple of comments. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We stand before you, Holy Spirit, conscious of our sinfulness, but aware that we gather in your name. Come to us, remain with us, and enlighten our hearts. Give us light and strength to know your will, to make it our own, and to live it in our lives. Guide us by your wisdom, support us by your power, for you are God, sharing the glory of Father and Son. You desire justice for all. Enable us to uphold the rights of others. Do not allow us to be misled by ignorance or corrupted by fear or favor. Unite us to yourself in the bond of love and keep us faithful to all that is true. As we gather in your name, may we temper justice with love, so that all our decisions may be pleasing to you and earn the reward promised to good and faithful servants. You live and reign with the Father and the Son, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
So I was saying these couple documents have a lot of information. As you are aware, we won't be able to do everything we have listed. I mean, this is a matter of common sense. It would take us, I don't know, 10 years of work, $20 million budget, possibly, to fix everything that is fixable, everything that is necessary or be convenient. And many of you have, maybe you feel strong about certain things, and it's very good, and we'll try to do as much as we can, prioritizing according to what the church is and the mission of the church. And there are needs that are opposites, and people say, do this, do the opposite. So my point now before Mr. Baker.
It's
working.
Is that one more?
No.
I mean, you would.
There we go.
Again, my point, we'll discuss, we'll prioritize, then this summer we'll do a feasibility study, we'll address as many needs as we can, but please, before the Lord, before our Lord, don't look at this as winning or losing. This is not like a political issue. That my party wins or my party loses. Even if the idea, whatever idea, I thought so strongly about it and I wanted and push and finally we can't do it. Or just as a pastor, sincerely, or bishop, as a responsible, we consider that it's not necessary, we have to postpone or it's not a priority, whatever the outcome is. They are not winners and losers here. We all win. We all win. Why? Because the church, as we hope, if we have the resources, will improve. And saying, oh, because my project was that, I don't know, to put an elevator, no, a second elevator, and it doesn't happen. And it doesn't happen, but still, we see another improvement. Good for all. Okay? So it's not like here a competition. You're going to be able to speak freely and share. And again, in, of course, I had things in my mind before starting the process. I got to learn many more things, things that were not my priority, but the things that I've seen that are important for many people. It's all about the church, the community, not individual interest or priorities. It's for the good of the body of Christ. So let me say it again. We all win. We all win, whatever the outcome is. You say, I know I'm going to lose money. If you don't want to give because your project is not the chosen one, it's up to you, between you and God. But if we get to do something, and if, even if at the end of the process, I know I only have the budget, the interest to paint this wall because it was the painting was falling off, and we improved one wall, we all win. Okay, if we fix a door that was broken, we all win. If we, I think it will be more than that. But we all, I think we all are going to win. Okay? That's there. So don't take it personal. It's good, and it's good that we get involved and emotional and strong about things. But at the end, with humility, it won't be your prayer, my prayer, it will be something we see all together. Okay? Thank you very much for your attention, Mr. Baker.
Thank you. All right, so as Father mentioned, my name is Steve Baker. I'm going to do a quick overview of the process that we've been going through so far. A little introduction to myself and Charles here, and hopefully our goal for tonight, we're going to cover that, and then we'll start getting into the good stuff. So my name is Steve Baker. I'm a native of Colorado. I've been practicing architecture for about 20 years now. Grew up in Colorado, went to St. Anne's, went to Regis, went to CSU, went to CU Denver for my master's in architecture, and I'm currently finishing up my PhD in Catholic Sacred Architecture at CU Denver as well. Been serving the Catholic Church in the Archdiocese of Denver all that time, basically. Worked quite a bit down in the Springs with an architect, worked nationally, and kind of cut my teeth on some cathedrals and some basilicas, young out of college. So we are here, we're on our fifth night. We have six total nights. Tomorrow is our last night for the large parish-wide stuff. So glad that y'all made it through the five. Tonight is the night, and tomorrow is the other night where we start deciding what we're gonna be doing. So the process has been through group discussions. We start off with the first day in the church, and then we start in group discussions talking about all of our needs. What does everybody need? And everybody met each other at the meditation on the invitation, or the visitation, which I thought was a great way to start off that day, where we approach each other in our needs, and we listed out all of our needs. Later on, we went through a series of casting dots. So we had a bunch of posters on the wall. Everybody got six dots, and they got to just prioritize however they wanted. It wasn't a majority vote. It's just kind of a way of getting a temperature to see where some of the priorities were that were kind of coming up out of the discussions. We are currently entering in workshop five. So tonight we're gonna do a little bit more discussion. We were given all of our information in four, which was last two nights ago, where we had all the information presented. We've actually updated that document quite a bit more. We'll go through that real quickly to show you what's been added to that. And then we've also produced another document, the P5, workshop five, which starts to throw out some ideas. These are not my ideas. Ideally, these are supposed to be a reflection of what we're hearing from everybody. That's the ultimate goal, is that we present something that is a reflection of what everybody is saying, and if we get that concord working, then we're there, ultimately, okay? I'm not trying to fit any agenda, and Father and I have no drawings going on right now, nothing behind the scenes. The only thing we do have going behind the scenes, and I'll show you tonight, is we did spend a few days on campus LIDAR scanning the entire campus. So we went out with the laser scanner and measured all your buildings, most of them inside and out. I'll show you what that looks like tonight and show you how we generated all these documents. Okay, so that's essentially all I have for the introduction there. The goal for tonight is we're going to discuss the summary of ideas presented. So in one of our packets, This large sheet is the P5, we're calling it, the Workshop 5 document. This is a summary of some ideas. The smaller document is revised version of what we presented in the P4, okay, so this was the fourth workshop that we had a couple weeks ago. Our goal tonight is to discuss the ideas in this and to see if they reflect what we have been saying as a parish and a school community. That's the ultimate goal. Okay. We're going to go back into small groups. I think that helps rather than pass the mic and everybody gets to shout out one thing and kind of no discourse back. If we work in the small groups, you at least get a little bit more civilized discourse happening. If we have time tonight, which I hopefully we do, we'll have a note taker, similar to what we did on the first night, where we had a scribe, writing down all the ideas and summarizing what that group discussed. Okay. We'll see how we go on time-wise. If we need to, we can kind of jump that into the next tomorrow night. So tomorrow's goal, these two are kind of in tandem. For tonight, I want to actually go around and gather up your documents. Either that, I'll photograph them so we can have them to coalesce them into another drawing. Ideally, tomorrow, we'll take what we hear from tonight, from your all's discussion, and generate one more idea. Ideally, that will coalesce all the ideas and priorities of what we're looking for through tonight's discussion. We'll discuss that idea tomorrow. And if need be, we can do another iteration of that as well, but we probably won't have another parish-wide meeting for that. Part of the other goal for tomorrow is to help get a sense from everybody who wants to be involved in the rest of the process. It's great you've made it through six nights. Now we're going to separate the wheat from the chaff, I guess, is that how? The strong from the really strong. Who wants to be on a building committee? So we'll kind of ask everybody to sign up and to see if you want to step up and help throughout the next process. So let's go ahead and go into this. I want to talk a little bit about what we changed or revised. Didn't really change much in the P4. So I will page through here. I'm not going to go through it. You can kind of read page by page. We're on page 2. 3 is that organizational makeup of the parish. 4 is kind of continuing that idea. We did add the family life ministries to this list on page 5. This is the smaller handout. The schedule did not change. Parish city populations hasn't changed. Parish population, those charts should be similar to last time. Parish population trends, none of that has changed. We did add this diagram on the bottom right, the outside parish boundaries. That was a discussion that we had as far as who's coming from our parish. Are we only getting people from the St. Mary's parish boundary line? You can kind of get a good sense of that data there to see that you're actually crossing quite a few of the boundaries. So it's not really that much of an issue. You're actually pulling some from Colorado Springs as well, actually quite a few. Looks like 32 here. Or maybe, yeah, somewhere in there.
So Steve, can you read what the parish boundaries are?
Where they go to? Not at the moment, sorry. No.
Okay.
Yeah. They're actually changing them too.
Our parish boundaries.
You mind if I use the map? Great. Probably in church boundaries have the shape of a L inverted, like the. Would be to the south, really it's a county line, yeah? And that's a division actually between the Diocese of Denver and Colorado. To the east, it's Broadway. To the north, it's pretty much, if I remember, you understand that might be one street up or down, but I think it's Littleton Boulevard, whatever it's up that, it's Old Souls. Then, to the west, is where it's not, OK, kind of a square shape, but it's a goes pretty much with a county line to Santa Fe, but it gets into Mineral to the west, and then goes up to South Platte Canyon Road, and then around I think it's Gold Mine Avenue, it's that part, and then it's Bowles. Can you picture the shape more or less? So that's, those are the boundaries. I think because they know normal parishioners are aware of it, and then people have a lot of flexibility regarding the boundaries. So we have to the west, we have Cabrini and Light of the World. To the north, All Souls. To the east, St. Thomas More. And then north, west, Holy Name.
St. Mark South.
And St. Mark South, but it's the Diocese of Colorado Springs. And within our boundaries, we have Our Lady of Mount Carmel, which doesn't have boundaries because it's a personal kind of parish. It's for those who prefer the Tridentine Mass rite.
Thank you for the question. I love your questions, and you're holding me to the fire. It's good. We'll add the parish boundary to the document here. All right, so that came up in that, as far as where we were pulling them from. Parish attendance, mass attendance has not changed. School enrollment was a discussion. So we got these updated figures from the principal and a projected figure for next year. That's on page 12. Religious RE enrollment hasn't changed. Liturgical design guidelines, this is from the Archdiocese. Those have not changed. I did include the Built of Living Stones, the documents that we had for the text that we had in the PowerPoint on workshop 3. Just so we have a record of that, because I know that was on a PowerPoint, and it'd be nice to have those as a reference. Obviously, there's a lot more to the Built of Living Stones. These are just the key categories that we pulled out for that. It's actually available online, so you can look at a PDF of that as well if you want to research it further. Income has not changed. Expenses did not change from last meeting. The income and expense comparison between those two did not change. This was an overview of an idea of what other denominations give. It's a little bit dated as far as it's the 1990s, but I'm going to give you a sense of that because we started talking about sources of funds. And this one is probably the most relevant for tonight. So we did take off the category for borrowing and a category for a second fundraising drive. It got too confusing because there was no intent from the administration to do a borrow or to have a secondary fundraise. So the intent was to have one fund drive, okay? So we took that information out. We can certainly discuss that if it ever comes up again, but just try to simplify this chart a little bit more. So three different methods. You can see the very top is a typical offertory method. Usually it's 2.5 to 3 times the yearly offertory. Gives you a good guideline for a 3-year fundraising campaign. So in the Archdiocese suggests the 2.5 to play it conservative. Okay, so we took a 2.5 conservative, multiplier times that, minus some fundraising fees, and then cash on hand for the project gives us a idea of potentially $7 million. The household method was taking the number of people who gave, kind of reducing that to the ones who were active parishioners, which is 1843. We assumed last time they had a higher percentage. We went ahead and adjusted that down to a 45% giving. Okay, so it's a little more, it's even more conservative than our last figure, so that's what's changed on there. So if 885 of the families contributed $3,200 over a 3-year campaign, there's a potential of $2.7 million. The last one was a similar project method where we took a project that we're currently working on and they have a 25%, which I've actually heard now is up 40%?
Yep.
Yeah. So they've actually been able to get there during the middle of their about a year, year and a half into the fundraising, they've actually been able to increase that from 25 to 40. Okay? So through the help of pastor talking about it a little bit more and through fundraisers kind of pressing it a little bit more. But we went with the 25% involvement on that one. So that gives you a parish size of 425, each family giving 3,000. They had a slightly smaller number. So we moved up to 3,000 to be comparable to some of the numbers St. Mary's provided us. See, Project A had a 1.4. And if you use a similar idea with the number of parishioners that you had, 5.9. All right, so the other sheet, 23, schedule and process. I'm just going to talk a little bit more about this one than we did last time. So we are wrapping up what's called programming, where we are identifying all the needs, the space requirements of that, what's first and what needs what, and how big that needs to be. Establishing a budget. Okay, so this is a budget. It's not exactly how much it costs. So it's a key understanding for tonight is we're establishing budgetary numbers. For designers to work within a budget is very wise. Okay, I would love to work without budgets and design all over the place. So we need to know what is feasible budgetary-wise and work within those parameters. It's a good restraint. The other thing here is on time. If you look on the left-hand side, there is the faster schedule, where we're currently in June programming and conceptual design. So a pretty aggressive schedule. We'd be looking at schematic design starting in July, which is now. So if we wrap up this week, if we know what we're doing, in theory we can start in schematic design right off the bat. With an optimistic goal of trying to hit the Marian Festival in September as a way of presenting all the ideas and getting everybody excited about the project. We still can't ask for funds until you go through the PFRC review. So it's get people excited about the parish project. It still can't be funded until we get permission from the archdiocese. I just want to make sure that it's a successful project. It's not to knock down every project and just be, you know, the dictator. They just want to make sure everything's successful. So they do a financial review of the parish's finances. We'll need to demonstrate ministerial need, which is exactly what we're doing in these 6 weeks or these six meetings, is establishing you all's need and that there is clearly a ministerial need. This is what the parish is asking for. This is not Steve Baker's fanciful dream of a church. You know, all right, I was gonna use other people's names, but I'll just use me. Okay, so it's not that. So we need to clearly demonstrate that this is clearly what the parish needs and is asking for. So if we submit to the Archdiocese in October, like I said, this is a pretty aggressive schedule. Usually it takes about a month for us to get approval to move forward into fundraising. At that point, we could start fundraising ideally in mid-November, puts us right at Advent. Christmas is right there. End of the year, tax reasons why you might want to give. So that's an ideal schedule. Okay, so we're trying to, I know the administration has also interviewed some fundraisers and they've been talking about that schedule as well, trying to work on that schedule. So potentially around Christmas, New Year's, we'd start a fundraising campaign, start your three-year campaign. The project does kind of go on a little bit of a hold at that point until you get 50% of the funds in hand. At that point, we can go back to the Archdiocese and then they can start starting up the consultants, architects, design team to start finishing off the drawings so that when you're done at the full 100% fundraising, you can actually go out to bid and get the project going on time. But during that fundraising, there's about a year and a half lull on our part, not on your part. Okay. The goal from schematic design is to produce quality and inspiring imagery. Inspiring imagery and understanding of the project so that you can communicate it to all the other 1,900 families that have not shown up tonight. And they can get all excited about the project as well, okay? I mentioned that before, that's kind of one of our specialties as a firm is being able to generate computer renderings, animations, walkthroughs, physical models, all that stuff. to help get that fundraising drive going. So from there on, it goes into a little bit more technical stuff. We're getting design, development, construction documents, setting it out to the contractor. We ultimately will know what the project will cost when we go to bid. All the way throughout this project, or this process, especially in schematic design, it is highly encouraged that we get general contractors on board to give us today's numbers working in today's environment, in Colorado's environment, while we're designing, okay? And it's highly recommended from the Archdiocese as well, and it's pretty much the way we work. So we will be working through schematic design with general contractors, getting real construction numbers on our schematic design idea, and tweaking the design as we're going along. What we're designing, we don't know yet, okay? So then we go to bidding, it goes into construction, you can see September 2019. Depending on what ultimately is done, it's about a 9 month to almost a year, year and a half, depending on what's ultimately done. Okay. I haven't seen St. Peter's on the list of things to do, so that might take a few more years. If you don't know that joke, we could do nothing or we could do St. Peter's or something in between. All right, so aerial photos, any questions on that? I don't want to get too far into all the nitty-gritty steps on that thing, but that's kind of, ideally we're looking on the left-hand side for an aggressive schedule to get rolling around Christmas time for fundraising. Okay. Showing the site, existing church and main floor, none of that really has changed other than a few tweaks, corrections. All of these drawings that we have in here are purely diagrammatic. I realize some of the doors, I haven't drawn any of the windows. Also, the office didn't do any of the site work around there as well. So they're purely just to get the square footages to understand the size of the spaces that you have now. Some may not even be named correctly or divided up correctly. This came up last time. We didn't have anything about the school. I apologize for that. And we now have all the school drawings. They are somewhat divided up in order to try to get it onto an 8.5 by 11, so it's a little bit more legible. To shrunk it down to microfilm. So you can see in here the main floor with the offices, the gym down below. 29, page 29. The elementary and preschool cafeteria. This is down one level, the main floor. Yep, need to tweak that one. Offices, the classrooms on the extension that kind of goes along the parking lot. The measurements for the cafeteria floor. I got that name drawn there. So this is actually the knuckle between the classrooms and the gathering space. The school gymnasium floor. This one's actually been rotated. So it's a little bit confusing. You can see over here is the offices. Would be up above this area here. So this is trying to fit that all in one sheet there. Nonetheless, we do have all the square footage calculations on that on page 34 to give us a general sense of what the spaces would be. We also included now the Parish Center to get a general idea of what all that included. There were some ideas that kind of came out of the discussion as far as some things to do at the Parish Center, and we needed to know the square footage on those. So basement, first floor, and upper floor. Upper floor is not completely accurate with all the offices, but we do have the square footage measured on there. The Parish response summary is the red dots. Like I said, this was what we did on workshop 3, I believe. We've just got a pulse, or maybe it was workshop 2. Yeah, I've got a general pulse of where everybody's interests were on the project. And addendum is any emails. Anything anybody's been sending me stuff, sending Sarah stuff. Wanted to just put it on the record, since we could easily put this into the document, what people are suggesting throughout these. So there's some light reading for you all on page 47. And I blocked out the names just to kind of keep it anonymous so people can say what they want on there. Some people had some great ideas. This was Sarah's poster that she had put on. which was some new ideas that no one had ever discussed, rectory and pastoral center. And some people actually sent me some sketches, which was good. Extending out the church, moving some choir seats, and adjusting. So there's notes about all this stuff. You can certainly read a lot of those ideas in there. Okay. Loved this one. It was thinking big. I think I replied back. Love the way you think. Think big. This one was extending out the sanctuary back towards the baptismal font. We got quite a few more seats, but looking at how the cry room and choir could be moved there. So it's just, I did ask for ideas, and these are some ideas to consider. Okay. And then this one is some kind of idea of iconography, which is great too. Okay. Someone really showed an affinity for Greek Orthodox temple at Alameda. All right, so a couple more things. I've been talking about this, just want to show you a little bit of what we've been doing. This is I can talk loud. So this is what I mentioned before, how we generate a lot of the documents. This was a LiDAR scan of the entire campus. So we were on, Charles and I in our office kind of went through and measured. There's about 280 scans on a tripod. All the facilities, most of this is exterior. Actually did the inside of the parish hall and inside the church, upper floor and lower floor. Just to show that we do have the ability to kind of accurately simulate, draw, design what you already have. If nothing else, it's a pretty cool tool. I'm just trying to wow you right now. But you can see we can go inside. It is accurate to a couple millimeters if it hit a point. So we know more than just from your drawings. We know exactly where everything is, where that poinsettia was on that day, how big it was, and whatever you need on the side of there. So we can use this to help explore these design ideas much better than before. Okay. Kind of go inside here. We can measure things. Like I said, everything's measured in a couple of millimeters, give or take. Half inch would be good for existing construction. Okay. So with that, we have started generating all those documents. They saw the floor plans and that stuff. One more thing is I want to demonstrate, I know acoustics have been a kind of a crucial piece. The acoustic of the sanctuary has been a crucial discussion piece. The choir loft has obviously been a very crucial discussion of that as well. We are also considering the ability to do an acoustic simulation of the space. So this is a different church, obviously. This is your church we're proposing. I told you there's no drawings. This isn't, no. Kidding. But in this, we can simulate the type of materials on the wall and how the acoustics get sent around. But I think it's fascinating if you can see where it hits the domes, how it starts to concentrate your sound. So as part of our service, we're going to be doing an acoustical analysis of the sanctuary if part of the sanctuary is part of the project. Okay, so just know that we can, and you can actually hear this as well. We can put an audio file in there, put the headphones on, sit where you want to sit and hear it. Okay. If nothing else, it's just darn cool. I'm going to spend 5 minutes just showing you cool stuff. So we can actually simulate this. If we need to look at choir being in different places, we can certainly test it before we get there and acoustically listen to it. It's a simulation, but it'll get us 80% of the way there until you're actually in the space, fine-tuning the equipment. You'll never get there. So that's kind of where we're going with all this 3D fun stuff. All right, so let's talk about any questions on that. Anything else, any other information you want to see that is crucial that we need to put in this document? That's great to know. Good enough?
Great question.
Yeah.
On those sheets, they had all the dots.
Yes.
You know, there was like half a dozen of those sheets. I just lost them right now.
They're in a small packet.
Small packet.
It seems like towards the bottom there was a concentration of dots. Did all those dots, were they concentrated on the last item, or were they left over?
Sure.
Or what?
So the guidance for the casting of the dots was category, if you just want that general category, kind of put it below. And then if you really wanted to focus on one line item as a key piece, then put it on that line item. So just kind of a way of going a little bit more micro, we're keeping it a little bit more macro on each category.
Okay.
So it's kind of like, I like everything in the church, let's just do all those things. I don't really have a priority. Like I said, it was a temperature more than anything. I don't really know how many dots were casted. I didn't count. I'm sorry. I will admit that right now.
I just wasn't sure if those last group of dots meant that last topic item, but you explained.
Yeah, if it's kind of in that big blank area, it's kind of just, I love the church, or I love the school, or I love the playground, or the party.
Do you
have a
mic?
I find it very emotionally draining to think of St. Mary's, who came in 1962 with Father McCallum. This church is no longer acceptable. Mm-hmm. Want to make it different. It's very emotional for somebody like me. Been here my whole life. Sons, communion, baptism. I just can't deal with it.
Was the very first church, were you having it this way? Or was it always this church with this extension? It flipped the way around.
The altar was.
Yeah. Is there a frustration with that flip and now another idea?
No. Flip was fine.
Okay.
Because it still remained the same. Those stained glass windows that people like us paid for, you know, that all remained. There was so much that just still stayed the same.
Just insist. Personally, I'm not looking at changing everything and remodeling, and it's basically the same. It's not that the church is not acceptable. It's that, like everything in life, can be improved. But doesn't mean that Father McCallum's work was bad or whoever came after. No, I think everything improves life, but it's perfectly acceptable. Is it acceptable the way it is right now? And it's in those stained glasses are fantastic, and there are things that are absolutely gorgeous in the church. Here and there, we're not looking, or personally not looking at changing it 100%. The percentage of changes can be in the 1%.
Father, are those changes, other than the budgetary issues, are any of those changes controversial from the perspective
of
the community
of
the church? I don't know.
Any
are supported wholeheartedly, or
are
there some controversial
arguments
or
what? We'll see. You have those in the dots, you can see in the document. When we get into more concrete choices, we'll see if there is more controversial. Again, don't expect now. Find the church in south north or whatever. No, it's not that other level we're talking about. There are things that can be arguable. People say, "Now, on the staircase here." There are things that are very agreeable. When we all talk about improving the staircase between the upper level and the basement, because the one we have now, it's very impractical. That's what I think everybody can realize. Then it's more difficult to decide where to put a new one, if we can afford it or how to do it. But there are things that can be more arguable. But we'll see. It's not just a big debate, the big debate so far.
And hopefully in workshop 3, I demonstrated, as far as my take on design, an affinity for all of tradition. Okay, so I'm not a, you're not gonna get the Arts Center Leapskin building plopped for your school. Okay, so an affinity and appreciation for that. That's something that I've kind of personally, like I said, that scales fall through my eyes and embrace that idea. The intent is not to do anything that everybody doesn't want to do. Okay. All right, so let's go on to this document here. Like I said, this is ultimately an attempt to try to reflect the things that we've been hearing. There's never been a discussion about flipping the church or sending it out that way or adding a whole new church on, okay? You could easily fit a new church on here, but there's never been a discussion for that, so we're not gonna present it. So that's the idea, is to reflect some of the discussion that's been coming out of our 6 nights here. So the way that this document is broken down is on the very first page. Let's not that guy. The construction cost assumptions. So this is gonna be, where did you get your numbers from? Like I said before, the ultimate goal of this is to establish a budget that we're all comfortable with, that covers enough of the elements that we need, all agree to do. So what we have on this is, on the first column, we have a fair, good, and excellent quality kind of level of range. On that, we have a cost per square footage. Now, mention that we're just in a cost per square footage realm right now. Is it made of stone? Is it all glass? Are we not doing anything? Are we just painting? That's design. We start determining what these things are. It makes no sense for us as designers to start designing things that you ultimately can't afford or can't do anyways, okay? Or don't wanna do, okay? All of that will come, like I mentioned, through schematic design. If we decide to do anything, we'll start figuring out what the design needs to be to fit that budgetary number, okay? The budget needs to adjust up or down, we can determine it at that point. So the 9% there is an adjusted inflation, a 6% inflation for construction at 1.5 years until you actually start constructing, to kind of give you an idea of what it would cost in 2019, September. That's based off that schedule that we looked at before. So all this is to try to get us numbers to help establish a budget. So the way that this is organized is on this page. Idea one tries to encompass all of the ideas that everybody suggested, and it even gives an idea of how this could be created by generating a couple of new things. On the back of it is the actual floor plan or the site plan. Let's see what we're looking at. So each sheet is kind of relevant to each other. Some people like to look at it graphically, some people like to look at the numbers. So we'll try to get through these, and then I want to have you guys discuss in groups the pros and cons of this, what ideas about each one make St. Mary's a better place, and what ideas don't, okay? Not so much this has to be my first priority idea, okay? We've got to kind of shift our ideas to a pros and cons of it and see what we can end up doing. As you can see at the very bottom of this, idea one, we're looking at a possible $10.2 million budget. Currently looking at your sources of funds chart that we looked at before, this is a reach, okay? Possibly beyond your reach, okay? I know Sarah and the administration have just interviewed 2 fundraisers. The fundraising process is, first off, to do a feasibility study. We, in essence, are doing a feasibility study. We are feasibly seeing what the parish wants and needs. But we're not doing an in-depth financial feasibility study. That's more what the fundraisers would do. You don't want the architect in there determining what your financial status needs to be, because you'll get St. Peter's. No, you won't. So in tandem with this is the feasibility from fundraisers, okay? They will want from us drawings. So we kind of this chicken and egg thing. What are you doing? Well, we need to draw your drawings to start talking to people about what is feasible from your parish. They'll get a sense of the financial feasibility and what they think they can raise to their experience. Okay? So that sources of funds will also be checked against what the financial fundraisers determine from their feasibility study. That takes, what did they say, 4 weeks or so? 4 or 5 weeks? 5 weeks. And ideally starting that in July. It's not asking you for money. It's just getting a pulse from the parish as far as what they financially think they could raise and what you can support. They may find the 10 million, but you know, that's a pretty good reach. Yes?
I'm going to put in this, the quality of materials, so that your feasibility study, I would think that you use good materials, right?
Right, so on the square foot numbers I'm using, back to that construction cost assumption, I'm using the middle. I'm not saying you're high end. No, I'm just using the middle number right now. What it's constructed of, that's all part of the design. Okay? So we're just trying to get a sense of what it could possibly, that we could do something within this budget that fits those parameters. I don't like cheap buildings.
Yeah, that's what I'm asking.
Yeah, ideally that you don't have to replace it every 30 years.
Yeah.
Okay. New sanctuaries or new churches, at least 7,500.
Okay. Yeah, the issues depicted are code compliance issues.
They will all be addressed primarily in schematic design, yes. Yeah.
What's not incorporated in these numbers?
No, it will be part of our schematic design process. All of our stuff will need to meet code. Yeah.
You won't do anything that's not in the code.
Right, but I mean, if the city threw a curveball and said, well, if you do this, you're going to have to do that.
Yeah.
You're going to have to do that.
Yep. Part of schematic design is engaging the city at that point. Because the first thing the city's going to want to know is, what are you doing? And we need to figure out what we're doing. And then we can draw drawings to go to them and say, we're looking to extend out here. Then they'll say, well, you're not meeting your green requirement for the city. You might actually have to put landscaping around to cover up some of your parking lot. Okay, yeah, it's one that will come up. So all those are part of schematic design. That's not something you want us to be doing during programming. Okay, and that is all part of the schematic design fee, part of the service. Something else to discuss about that is all the consultants will run typically through the architect. So we will act as an agent for the client, the building committee, the master. And then we will engage our own consultants as needed, structural, electrical, mechanical. You don't want us spending money on a mechanical to go look for mechanical right now if we're never going to touch mechanical. Once we know what you're going to do, we'll start tapping into all those people. Okay. Structural, acoustic. All right, so they're generally divided up into categories, and I was pretty consistent with the categories across these. The top one, starting off with the church, very broad ideas of what would be involved in that number. Is the confessional next to the elevator? That's not the point right now, okay? All of those little, it's kind of like we're doing the dots in the large area, and we know that they need to include all these smaller dots inside. It's whether or not we can get it to schematically work. Okay, that's the next step. So an idea one, and then, sorry, from each one of them, I did idea one, down to stripping it all away, down to 1.6 million, just moving the choir along. Doesn't mean it's the priority of things to do, but from the dots and from a little bit of discussion, I've heard it does seem to be a priority item. Okay, I'll just put that out right now, and we can discuss that in the tables. Okay.
And I can see mixing and matching.
And so our idea here is you're going to discuss and things will rise that become their priority. And if one keeps rising up, we adjust. Okay? We pull things out and move things out. Okay? If there's an item on here that's missing, we need to know that as well. If there's something that... Okay, but they're in general, we're kind of top level still. Schematic design, we'll start getting into the weeds. Where the doors are, and where ramps are, how many parking you need. So then we have parish center and offices. In this idea, idea one, maybe I'll just talk about the site plan a little bit. There was a discussion last class, or last class, there we go, your teacher's been here. of adding new offices for the school. So taking generally, I think it was about 4,000 square foot square, said that might be an idea. Does it go there? Maybe not, okay? That's another design discussion as well. Where exactly, so this is where the offices are, adding on, bumping out, that seemed to be a natural idea for right now, to just throw out the idea. New offices, how many offices does it have? We can fit within 4,000 square feet, some pretty nice offices, a lot of space. Okay. Exactly which offices go in there and how it attaches into the other office, that's the next step, if we decide to do that. So this idea of perhaps a covered walkway between the two, I think that mentioned as far as a drop-off. There was a lot of discussion about rerouting the drop-off. That one I haven't drawn anything because it involves a little bit higher level of city planning and civil engineering. So we know it's on there and we know it's a consideration as far as trying to change the drop-off and suggesting maybe a curb cut here, but you got a stoplight here, you have a weird intersection here. Involves a little more top level discussion. So don't really have any of those drawn on there. School facility upgrades. This is a catch-all. If you notice inside of here, on this $10 million idea, facility upgrades, a $500,000 upgrade, and field and grounds. There's a lot of discussion about field and grounds. What exactly that is, we need to prioritize that at a smaller level. On this one, an idea of perhaps building a parish center here. There's a lot of discussion about new meeting spaces and the need for other ministries. Could we turn this into ministries, youth center hall, youth center, food pantry, reconvert that into a ministries building and build a new parish center upstairs and downstairs? I think we have about 10,000, roughly about 10,000 square feet to build that. So there's an idea what that could cost, a budget for that. Ave Maria and Marian Hall was this. There was a lot of discussion about upgrading this. There was a kitchen discussion. The number in here for that is just a whole new kitchen, whole new commercial kitchen, $400 a square foot. Should be, I don't know exactly what's in the kitchen there, what would be needed to be done, but there's a line item for that idea. New school offices, facility upgrades. We already talked about that. Rectory, large discussion about that. There was a discussion about the bathrooms, new carpet throughout. So right now, exactly what that is, we provide a preliminary budget of 110. Parking and sidewalks, some of the big ones there were for refinishing the existing lot, regrading it so we don't have all the ice problems. And a lot of people were mentioning lighting across the whole camp, or at least in the night. Okay, so preliminary allowances for that. The other one that was good from the last discussion is at the very bottom, outside of construction, was to develop a maintenance fund. So that's something that came out of this whole workshop, the importance of having that for the down the road. If during schematic design, when we tap mechanical engineers and structural engineers, and they say, more mechanical, your boiler's good for probably another 5, but you need to start planning in 10 to get a new one. The idea here is this maintenance fund starts building up for that. So we make that part of our capital campaign. There's a chunk that's allocated for that, set off to the side.
Can you just reiterate for the people who weren't here at the previous sessions why that was an issue? What the current state is?
So the current state was that the boiler upstairs was going, and the school needed it as well. Is that right? So to kind of go with this, we have not done a mechanical assessment of this because that would require tapping into consultants to do that. But there was concern for the mechanical system in the sanctuary and over for the school.
Okay. And part of our operating budget, there's no allocation for replacement of capital items like that.
Right, and so right now there is no plan for 5 years to replace that. Okay, so this would help get a jump start on that and maintain that maintenance fund for longevity of the facilities. Okay, and then through schematic design, when we start tapping those consultants, we can start saying, well, this one's a more priority. So the maintenance fund could potentially be for that one. Okay. But that's outside of construction costs. It's a little bit different there. And then on the chart on the right-hand side, just kind of show a little bit of the balance in this idea. Everybody wants something. It's going to cost a little bit. But you can generally see in the allocation of that budget that it's pretty evenly split. If you consider site being kind of shared between both of them, you can see over here at parish offices, church, and then school, and then kind of common categories across the two there. So idea two is to look at reducing some of the scope. And in idea two, the school is the one that takes the hit. Idea three, it's the parish administration that takes the hit. So you're gonna look at both of those, because there was a good discussion last time as far as that is what is priority between those two items there as well. Okay, so idea two, you can see, let's look at the site plan, it shows it a little bit easier. School upgrades, new parish center, so we lose the offices. Okay. But we still upgrade the facilities. You look at the mechanical system on there and what we can do for that budget there. Parish center and offices, essentially all the renovation ideas to the church, the Marion Hall, remain the same except for the kitchen. I think the kitchen is out of that one. Yeah, $100,000 upgrade for things that we want to do for Marion Hall. Okay. So in this case, the same idea, this becomes a ministries center, youth center. If the youth center were moved over in here, perhaps in the basement, so they have, you know, access out to the barbecue area in the backyard, you've now opened up a large space in the school. What that becomes, we could certainly look at that, okay? Maybe that plays, I have no idea how, but maybe it plays somehow in the offices. It's kind of in the back of the building. Maybe there's something in there that can be upgraded as part of that, that new open space becomes something else. So it was just an idea to think a little bit about how we can move some functions around. New parish offices and centers, some meeting areas down below, or offices down below, maybe a meeting center up top. Renovating the gathering space. There's a large number for the worship space. That's to take into consideration. Maybe there's a mechanical thing we need to really consider. Okay. When I'm mentioning here existing sanctuary, that essentially is the steps and the back wall. That's kind of the square footage for that area. Okay, so that one's obviously focusing a little bit more on parish center and church and a little less on grounds. And well, it still has the maintenance fund on there. Idea three. On 7 and 8. You can see kind of parish administration goes down and school kind of comes back up. So the idea here, school offices back in. Parish addition thing is not. That this just gets renovated and stays the same as the parish center, parish offices. But it gets upgrades, because there's a lot of, there's mention for windows, there were problems with it. It's hotter than goodness in the conference room today when we met earlier. Renovate existing rectory, and then some school upgrades, kind of same idea there. And I think most of them had the restrooms in the chapel. That was a lot of dots on that one. Okay. Let's see what else has kind of changed on that one. Yes?
Just a quick question. If you do not add change the parish offices to build on here, does that mean that the stairway doesn't change?
So there is an allocation inside the church, renovate existing gathering and support, that's 4,300 square feet. That is, in general, all of that gathering space plus the vesting, plus all those stairs. So there is $700,000 in there. How much you could do architecturally or structurally with that kind of a budget, it's a little bit tight.
So it's more likely to happen if you build on parish offices?
if we decided to just focus on gathering space and upgrading that with the 700,000, we probably would put quite a bit just into the stairs and not so much moving gift shop around. Or we probably could move confessional rather easily and work on that transition between the church and the gathering space, because there is a significant amount of money in the gathering, right, in the worship space. So we kind of pull from that budget to work on this budget. So there are things we could do. We haven't looked at it, though, how we could get that to work. If you wanted a larger, I'm looking at it right now, larger stairwell, you're going to have to eat into something else to stay within this footprint. Could it be a smaller bump out? Absolutely, but once you start bumping out, you might as well start to bump out. And, you know, the bump out doesn't have to be the 10,000 square foot parish center. That budget could be smaller as well. It could be just working on that access down there. Okay?
Are you saying a new entrance from that direction? Without being a parish center?
If you had the parish center there?
No, without the parish center. It would just be a new entry and a new stairway.
We'd have to look at it. Probably not with the $700,000. Okay. We'd probably go out a little bit more to get more of an entry, if you wanted that to be the entry. In my mind, as I'm discussing it, I would say probably entry stays the same as it is now, if you're trying to work within this kind of budget. These are the things that we'll do in design. If we know this is our budget, then we got to make things work and build it out of the things that we can, so that it's good and better than good quality, depending on where it is. I mean, some things don't need to be granite and, you know, highest and marble. So, yep. So kind of right here where my hand was. Between here? Mostly I'm trying to keep the square footage within reason. If we connected it and you wanted to stay within a top end of 10 million, you're probably looking at a pretty thin, narrow connection, which is kind of odd. But we can certainly look at connecting that with a larger facility, but that means kind of pulling away other things as well. It's more trying to stay within a reasonable budget.
I'm just wondering, I mean, if you're bumping anyways, and you're digging and you're doing all
in between those, so just to give you a sense of scale, in between those, we can kind of do it here. This is your church. You can put almost a church and a half in there, so it's a large building, whatever you're trying to connect with. So that's what I'm kind of avoided that, because you're getting more square footage than you probably would ever dream. Does that make sense? And then we're also probably eating quite a bit of green space, which will become an issue. Once we start bumping out, there's going to be, we got to see if asphalt, the city might say, hey, you need the back green space, you got to take them somewhere else. Yeah.
Could you give me an idea of what these professional fees and expenses and how?
Right. So professional fees, so that is typically based, and I just did 11%, which is a good estimate for what you can do for architects, structural, mechanical, acoustical, all those people to generate the drawings from, here I get an RB4 fees, right? And this, so this right here kind of give you an idea of all the steps. Professional fees will basically cover from schematic design, architects, all the engineers. Sometimes, you know, it can cover the fee of the contractor or construction estimating. And pre-construction through what's called pre-construction services. I mentioned structural, mechanical, plumbing. Civil sometimes is either added or part of it. Landscape engineers, if you need any landscape architects. So that covers from schematic all the way through construction is the bulk of it. But even through warranty, architects will stay on to help you go through your 1 year, 2 year warranty walkthroughs as well. So it's to cover all the services, to generate all the drawings to get actually built, and then actually to walk it through construction. So if you remember, I mentioned the architect is basically acts as the agent or the voice for the owner throughout this whole process. Father won't be out there telling the contractor what to do. He shouldn't. Right? And I won't tell him what to do. All we do is check to make sure that they follow the design guidelines that we've set out. And then go through payment or, you know, lots of fun stuff. Okay. So it's basically hiring those consultants and engineers and architects through that two and a half year process almost. Okay. And sorry. Typically it's around 8 to about 15% of construction costs is one way of figuring that out. We will go through a negotiation phase after we figure out what exactly you guys are going to be doing. We'll go through a negotiation phase to figure out what that fee will be. But that just gives you an idea. So the 11% kind of covers everything that we do professionally. Okay?
In the upgrade of the church or renovation, is there a separate, or is it part of that total fee, the downspouts, the drainage of the roof, and the parking lot on the north side of the building?
Are you on 7? Which one are you? ID 3?
On any of them.
So we have in there for rent, underneath our site, we do have our parking number in there for that.
Would parking on the north side be part of parking
yes.
in general?
Yep. And so the $500,000 allowance for that, Sarah might be able to speak a little bit to that. She recently has got a number on that. Can you tell us what all included?
Vinny got a number on that most recently, and that would be the entire parking lot.
Are you doing it? Now, whether or not it's drainage, we need to put that as a priority as far as an exterior category for the church. And actually, that's a good thing we need to consider in this. It's one that is missing from this. It's an exterior aspect of the church. So it's a good catch on that one.
What is about, well, okay, you move the choir along. What happens to the organ?
It gets moved, I would imagine. You wouldn't want to get rid of it.
Okay, well, what I saw was they have the choir as on one of the side arms of the existing church. So, where would you put it?
Where are we going to put the choir?
Pardon? No, I know where the choir is. So you would move the organ pipes and everything else off to where the choir is, which I guess would be the
it's a design question. If we start looking at that back wall, there are numerous churches that have lovely organs behind the altar. It's how we can work that design to keep it there if that is one of our goals, is to kind of keep that aesthetically and functionally and cost-wise. We'll determine that.
Okay.
That sound is going to blast right out there.
Right.
The current organ, we hear each pipe, right? It's not, it's perhaps an electrical transfer from the organist to the pipes, but we hear the pipes, right? It's not a, so if you move that, then looks like you're really throwing the acoustics off if you put it to one side or anything else like that.
So if we can study the acoustics on that and see if there is still able to move them, we can. If not, then we need to keep them there if acoustics is one of our high priority needs, right? Which it is.
Right? I mean, the organ doesn't have to be in the pipes.
Are you talking about the console itself? Or are you talking about the pipes?
The console can go anywhere. That's how they
think. If acoustics is our, so let me, here's how, this is a design question, right?
Yeah.
If acoustics is a very primary thing, which it is, and if it makes us the most sense to keep them there, then that is a parameter that we should work with in our design. If they need, if they can stay there, how can we make this work as well? If moving the choir loft or moving the choir is one of our other requirements, we've got a conflict, and the design will hopefully resolve that conflict. If the intent is acoustics as primary, then putting them down in the basement doesn't make any sense, right? Or putting them off to the side that shoots them out this way, and your acoustics just bouncing off your two parallel walls. It doesn't make any sense, so hopefully I won't, or we won't, propose that idea.
So then you would remove the bulk of the floor for the loft, but leave the back wall, the east wall, with the pipes there?
Potentially, yes.
Okay. Kind of getting into the weeds right there. That's a design issue that will resolve when the time comes. Right now, it's priorities. What are your priorities? That's what we're going to understand.
And the key one is the acoustics of it.
Right.
And to not ruin that, I completely agree. I was up in it, and he couldn't hear me talk, so I agree. It's bad acoustics. Yes.
So is movement of the choir in general a priority?
It sure seems to be from what I'm hearing. From a lot of the, I want you all to talk about this because I know it's hot for several people, okay? But from the thoughts and from our general discussion, from the liturgical documents as well, I just want to hit you over the head with the Archbishop or what the documents say. It seems to be a priority.
But the policy is a sacramental thing or something along those lines.
Yes, and that was a lot of our discussion last week as well.
Thank you.
Yep.
What's the relationship between demoing the choir and then the cost to reconstruct the sanctuary? As opposed to leaving...
So I'm a big contractor on you. Tell me what that new sanctuary looks like, and I'll give you a cost.
Well, but opposed to leaving the structure and reducing the cost of renovating the worship space.
If it works, let's do it. If it's a great idea and saves us a lot of money, let's do it. I haven't drawn any drawings. You're just seeing it right here.
It's also a significant change to the architecture of the church.
Yeah, if you can leave the structure, we're not touching the structure. I've looked at some of the structural drawings. I haven't looked at them enough to give you a preconceived idea of what needs to happen. If the structure makes sense, and pulling out all those stairs to the second floor just really doesn't make any sense, then if we can do liturgically, because we have this liturgical aspect that we need to resolve, and do it as minimal as possible, absolutely, why wouldn't we do that, right? Does that make sense? And what that costs, let's get some drawings together and shoot it to a contractor and let's give us some numbers. So we've got drawings. It's a reiterative process. We'll do that all throughout schematic design. Okay.
I have another question. The idea, and this was a new idea tonight that was introduced, with the church offices attached to the west end of the church.
Right.
Why don't you leave the offices as they are? The offices are already configured as offices. Upgrade them, make them nice and comfortable. HVAC, windows, whatever you've got to do. And attach, if we're going to attach a community food bank,
yep,
offices and stuff on the west side, make it so it's new and diverse for the whole area.
And to some degree, it's just changing names on the label that we just talked about, right?
Yep.
To switch those two labels. Great idea. Write it down. Okay, so these are, I thought of the ideas as well. It's taking like 30 ideas up here. We've only gotten through three right now.
To add that, I just got commented to W. Robert, is I cannot visualize how you would make the current parish and building work for the food pantry particularly.
Okay. How we make a lot of these things work is, we do it again, it's design. So I'm going to keep pulling that on you, but that's where we are.
I mean, if you put the food pantry on the west end on the bottom level, with great separation to the north, you could have dock or loading in the north. Well, everything could be done on the north side.
Sure. What are you doing for the next year?
Pardon?
What are you doing for the next year? Tomorrow night is committee, building committee formation. Think about it. I would love it. Okay. Yes.
Just to think safety first and not to of sticks somewhere edging out safety.
So as a professional, we are required to include safety. You have to meet code, you have to meet all these standards.
But to keep in
as part of the lesson.
Bare minimum one, everything else may or may not fall as people really willing on the whole just to
do. Absolutely. Doesn't make sense. The building's going to fall down on you first design it. Or if you're going to fall walking in. Absolutely. Or if you can't get in, if you can't get in and get out. Okay. And I know there's an aging population. There's a lot of requirements there. So I think that kind of also goes to an exterior component as far as budgeting for this church.
ADA.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. ADA. Yeah. Not being flippant, but yeah, absolutely. Yes. Once we start touching things, we're going to be required as professionals to start upgrading things like that. And typically, that's included in these rough square footage number ideas. But what
it's
it takes
not
to renovate.
Say
what?
It's not included in your cost.
No, to renovate an existing sanctuary or to renovate existing gathering support, that would be part of that cost. Whether I have a line item for egress doors, that on my part, or as an architect, assuming that that is part of what is entailed with renovating an existing space. Okay. Typically, when you're estimating out, you won't have a safety line. You'll have panic doors that will have those. Will have panic doors on all the doors, slip guards, you know, handrails. Sure. All that will be part of the design. It has to be.
So, maybe just a blanket statement. Everything that we're going to do, everything that we're putting in the document, is going to meet ADA requirements. Has to meet all code requirements. It's going to be safe.
And I'm not questioning that. Okay. I'm questioning. Are these budget numbers realistic? Now, I know you said they're preliminary. We need a GC to get involved and all that. But what percentage are we looking at, perhaps, on making things more compliant? Is it beneficial to say that, you know, it's half a percent of the construction cost? You know, I don't know. But part of me is saying, you know, you have kind of a basic idea of what everybody interjected. And my thought process is get the city involved now to find out if we touch this, what are you going to make us do? No, I think we're good for part of the course. That's my thought.
Okay.
So all of these alternatives have the church entry on the south side like it exists now. Have you considered putting it on the west side and expanding an outdoor living area or an outdoor space like a plaza to connect the school?
It's a great idea. It's a good idea. We have to flatten a little bit of land there, but yeah. So let me get back to our goal. Our goal is to prioritize which areas are important. We don't care about the church, we just want the school stuff. You know, we just need the parking lot. All of this will come through, a lot of these ideas and answers will come through design.
I'm looking at all this, and all looks very interesting, and everything has its point, but I'm really concerned that we're not looking at a hierarchy of needs, we're looking at a hierarchy of desires. And I would really like it, for me, when I do my family budget, I look at what are the absolute things that need to be taken care of first. Then I say, can I buy artwork? Can I add on something to my house? Can I do those things? And I feel like I'm not seeing that constructed this way.
Because that's what we're here today to do. We want to make that list with you guys now. If we do that list for you, then you're going to get something that we want, not what you want.
So, ultimately, we're probably not going to get it tonight because we're still on item three. We'll come back and discuss all of how these, we need to get, what are our needs from each one? What are our priority needs? We've already listed all of our needs. So what are our ultimate needs? Okay. Given this idea of numbering, so we're just trying to throw this financial idea in here as well, that given that idea that things cost money, that we can't just list all the things that we need and expect it to somehow work. We need to be looking more at a 5 a reach $7 million budget. This is to give you ideas to kind of help you prioritize what is our need right now within that kind of budget. Okay? Does that help? Or? So the goal here is we're going to discuss this. We're getting a little bit group large discussion here, but it's fine.
Wouldn't you say, just overall, that once we decide on a budget, things are dynamic and changes may have to happen and certain things get value engineered out and some of the nice-to-haves get taken out over time in order to stay within the budget because the must-haves stay in?
And ultimately, that is the role of the building committee, who represents a lot of the ideas that they can fight, for lack of a better word, for those ideas that they really felt strongly that the parish said they wanted this. You can't be taking this out when we're value engineering things out because we've got a budget for something that's twice the price. Which I, you know, that's the ultimate goal of the
is
built
that, I mean,
street.
That's a reassurance, though, that we would stay within the budget.
Absolutely.
Where people are worried that this is realistic, because that's the way we manage it.
Right. So we're trying to give you a realistic idea of what it would cost. So that you can prioritize. Is that what you're saying or no? Okay. I just want to make sure we're saying the same thing, yeah. Okay. Question? Yeah.
I think it's very good. And I think that some people have agreed that with the spreadsheet that you're arriving to figure out. This is this. You know, every line item should be looked at. Because from 100% ideal wise, you go down to 16% in five. So what do we get? What are we talking about? I have to get to follow up the same page.
Right. So during schematic design, when we start determining what it is made of,
you have it already.
I don't have every line item generated.
Your best gift is you all do that.
Yes.
You're doing it optimally.
We have not assessed your mechanical needs as far as that yet. That would be requiring us to tap into a consultant, which, to be honest, costs money.
Sorry, what?
What he's asking for is of $1 million to renovate the sanctuary. If you just pull that out of the air, or do you have an idea of what is inside there? If you just went by square footage, you took out an estimate, X dollars a square foot times square footage, all you have is a bag of money. All you have is a bag of money. How can anybody in any business make a decision on a bag of money? Right? You normally come in with a high level what I need plan. And then you can go back. All right, if I can fit that into your $1 million, you go right ahead.
Right.
Okay? And what we're saying is, if you've just done that, square footage times estimated cost, you're just asking us to give you a bag of money. And then go back in with another set of people and prioritize that. And what you have in this room here, a couple hundred people out of a group of 1,900 families, I wish you the best of them.
So the,
thank you, Sarah.
Yeah. Yeah. The challenge is we've got to start somewhere and to help you to prioritize what is needed to say that we can do these things in these different areas. We absolutely will have a line-by-line item estimate. We don't know exactly what you're doing in it. What I need to hear from you all is which pieces are the most priority to you. Because I think we still have a bit of discussion as far as the choir loft. Are we all in agreement that we need to move the choir loft?
No.
No.
So we still need to have this discussion. Right? What?
It's been here for 10 years.
Rephrase the question.
Move the choir.
That's right. Moving the choir.
Moving the choir.
What is the difference between renovating existing sanctuary and how is that not part of the existing worship area?
So the idea behind the numbers between behind the sanctuary is it, they're usually a higher grade material. There's usually a little bit more craftsmanship behind the sanctuary, so this is the stairs around the altar and the back wall. The idea was to generate something for the back wall. If we are, we can design all of these pieces and give you prices for all these pieces, but I don't think you want to be doing that. So we need to find out what pieces you want us to be designing for you, ultimately. For us to go down and to give you an idea from our experience of what it takes to renovate a sanctuary. That's what these numbers are based on. Okay. But for us to go down and figure out all the design details on it, we will stay within that budget idea, if that's what we agree to. It's not, and I think there's a little bit of misconception that it's giving me a bag of money. I don't, that's not the intent here. Okay. I'd be fine just giving you a bathroom for your reconciliation chapel, or whatever. The goal is to find out as a community what we need to do.
Yeah. Yeah. Each of the ideas, each of the five ideas, which I don't think are finished, by the way, but pretty cool, they all have one line item called musical instrument based on percentage of construction. Could you elaborate on that?
So typically, funds for like an acoustical system, a sound system, will usually come in after a construction contract. It can be included in a construction contract, but it's not typically. So allowing some money for an acoustical system, upgrades to the acoustical system. Or it can typically be, we want an organ. So it's to allow some money for, that we do need, we do see an acoustical system in the need, so we need to allow, allow some money for that. Yeah. That's the way it's going to work out, yes. In light of some of the discussions that we're having, the questions people are having, should this be happening tomorrow night? So let's go through the ideas. We're getting up on our at least an hour and a half now. So I want to explore the ideas. Tomorrow night we're going to have a discussion about this, and we're going to try to get to, we need this done. Okay? So. We're on idea three. So idea four. Another way to look, here's another way to think about this. Another way to think about these ideas is they've started to prioritize things. Idea one, everything was even, we're doing everything. As we start whittling away, I have made an attempt to one, prioritize the parish center, to two, prioritize the office, the school office, okay? In this idea, we're prioritizing the church. You can see in the allocation of funds, it's priority, okay? Yeah. So in this one, you have the church. Go to the next one page here. School upgrades, renovating the gathering space, keeping the offices as where they are, upgrade. I like the idea of a new parish center here that is just the ministries and meeting rooms. Is that something that is a new idea that we really like as a community, keep this as the parish offices and build a bump out here? I think the bump out's been kind of a good discussion. Do we want to have that bump out and explore that idea? If that's what you want, we'll draw it up and we'll get you line by line items on it. I'm trying to give you an idea of what that 10,000 square foot would look like, okay? You have to start in this larger square foot realm, okay? But if that is a priority and we like that idea, hopefully this is great. Someone didn't even think about this idea of a parish center even being over here. It was something that came out of this early, early design. Okay. Are there a lot of, let's discuss that idea. Are there a lot of positives of that? We keep the parish offices where they are, and we look at this bump out, what does that solve? What are the pros and cons of that? Does it solve a lot of our problems? Do we need, then if we do that, do we really need these offices? Maybe not. Maybe that's a phase two down the road, a master plan idea. Okay? Tomorrow night, I will draw that idea. We'll have that for tomorrow to explore that idea. Okay? We're on number four here. Providing allocation of funds for the school upgrades, no offices. Upgrading the gathering space. Is the priority on the gathering space the stairs? Obviously that is, because we can't get downstairs. There's some safety issues there. There was mechanical systems in the church, the choir loft, and keeping the restrooms in there, renovate the existing rectory. Do we need to renovate the rectory? Should we get that out of there? Do the offices need renovation? Okay. Because ultimately, that budget of a $5 million budget, you all have to be comfortable with. Okay? Or the $1 million budget, or the $7 million budget. You have to be comfortable with that. And if you think you can do the $7 million, I didn't tell you to, but let's go. Right? I will give you advice, and perhaps not, but let's talk with the fundraisers as well. Okay. So that gives you an idea of what those are, just kind of peeling off the different layers and prioritizing in idea five, just the church. Ultimately, when we decide what's in that church, we'll have you have the line item numbers on it, okay? But to say that we could renovate that sanctuary for $1.2 million, in the discussions I've heard, possibly, depends on what we end up doing. Or could we add offices onto the school for $192 a square foot? I think so.
Okay. Steve, is idea five really realistic? Because we've backed off the parking lot, and it's $500,000 on every one of the other plans, and it's a given that we have to do it. So this isn't really a realistic proposal.
And the same could be said about the $10 million. Right, that it feasibly could be.
We've got $500,000 into the parking lot, regardless of which of these plans.
The parking lot is a priority.
That's a constant.
Okay, so then that's, maybe the other approach is to go the other way up. If we all agree with the church renovation, we need parish. We need the parking if it's added back on there, okay?
I do think you still need a maintenance budget.
And the maintenance budget is pulled out. The idea is to pull this thing down as far as we can to zero. And the next idea is zero. Was that? Yeah. So let's kind of wrap this up. So tomorrow night, look at these. I want you to come with, we need the maintenance thing. Okay, we can't go without the maintenance thing, which is a very wise decision. We have to have the parking. That's something that this group will talk about, and they'll say, we have to have that. Now, if we all end up saying that we all have to have everything, then you're looking at a two-phase fundraising commitment in a 10-year project. Maybe that is the answer. We need to find out what's in phase one. Think of it that way. Maybe there's a phase one. We absolutely need this one. Let's put that in phase one. If we want it all, then we're looking at a two-phase thing. That's 10 years. Maybe I'll be here in 10 years. I don't know. It, you know, I'll be here for the first phase, for sure.
Steve, is it reasonable tomorrow night to start talking about each segment or each building, whatever the case? When there's a line item for the budget, we say that you could give just a quick scenario.
What's in it?
What that entails.
I mean,
I think that'll help people get a better idea of what we're going to decide.
Yeah, my hesitation is not to get into the line by line item of it, but yeah.
Generally speaking,
absolutely.
This is what it is.
Yes. Yep. So if we, yeah. So should we wrap up? And everybody's trying up here. I am going to drink water. So if you're strong, are we still strong for another half hour? What I would like to do, let's go till 8:30, is everybody in your groups. It's great that we're starting to do this. The only problem with that is it's just me and you dialoguing at this point. And when, if I pass the mic, then it's just one person Facebooking out and everybody's just gonna look at it because you're just shouting. So if we're in groups discussing it, what I'd like for you to do is pick one person to write it down and do the next half hour. Tomorrow we'll present it. Everybody think about this, sleep on it, pray on it, pray about it, okay? Do you have signs of what these ideas possibly could cost? So what I want you to do in your group, think about, here I got a couple ways of approaching this, hold on. Go ahead and have one scribe go through it. When you're gonna present, you're gonna do, let's do two ideas that kind of really brought it up. So I'm trying to use you all as the parishioners, and then you have one scribe that's essentially kind of like a building committee person that speaks for that group. We're not gonna go through schematic design, construction documents, design development with all y'all here. Ideally, we're gonna have building committee people helping, speaking with you and speaking for you. Hold on.
Time's up.
Does that make sense? So one scribe is gonna write down all the ideas. As a group, you're gonna be picking two that you say you really need. Let's focus it on that way. These two things we really need as a parish. Okay? You gotta pick. So I'll give you a half hour for that. Tomorrow we'll meet and present those. So here, you're not gonna leave it, or you could leave it. What I was gonna do is photograph them all real quick. It's an easy way to make, and then you can keep it. Rather than me keeping it, trying to remember whose group it was. Or actually, you know, I probably could. Does anyone, bring your tablets up here, anyone who's the note keeper, put a number on it or remember who you are, hopefully. And I'll gather those tonight. What I'm gonna do is kind of coalesce some of those ideas, just looking globally tonight. And tomorrow we'll get our office to kind of wrap these up into another priority, listening to what everybody's saying. Tomorrow you'll present those, one or two ideas. And we'll try to get this thing to a head. Father, you wanna close with the prayer?
Okay. Let's conclude. Let's finish this evening with a prayer. We'll pray to glory be, because everything we do is not to feed ourselves, to sue ourselves, but to for the glory of the Trinity. Okay. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. This was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you again. See you tomorrow.